Welcome to the 21st lecture in the course Engineering Electromagnetics. In this lecture, we continue with our discussion on reflection and refraction of waves, and the topic for discussion today is what is called the plane slab. You would recall that so far what we have discussed is the case of a single interface on either side of which we had infinite media. But if let us say the medium on which the plane wave is incident is of a finite extent, then one can easily visualize that the wave is going to encounter two interfaces instead of one, and therefore the interaction of the wave with the interfaces is going to be more complex, and such a case is known as the case of a plane slab. The slab could be made of any material in general, but as we will see, to derive some special results, we will consider that the slab is made of perfect dielectric material. The slab is represented in the following manner. We consider that this is an interface between, say, medium 1 and medium 2, and medium 2 is in the form of a slab, so that this is an interface between medium 2 and medium 3, and medium 2 extends over a width which may be d, and therefore this is the thickness, d is the thickness of the plane slab in medium 2. We will consider the case of normal incidence. The case of oblique incidence can also be considered, but is going to be more complicated. So, we consider the case of normal incidence of a uniform plane wave on such a slab from medium 1. Let us say that the incident wave represented by say EI is incident like this, and we are showing it incident in this manner for the sake of clarity. Otherwise, the wave is incident at a normal angle. Okay. Now, part of the wave is going to be reflected back at this interface, which we may call E R 1 2. Please take note of the convention or the notation. 1 2 represents the reflection at the interface between media 1 and 2 for a wave traveling from medium 1 to medium 2. While part of the wave is going to be reflected back, part of the wave is going to be transmitted into medium 2. Let us say it is transmitted in this manner, and what is transmitted may be called as E t 1 2 following our convention. So that when this transmitted wave travels to the second interface, it will have got changed in its phase by an amount equivalent to the phase shift constant of medium 2 and the thickness or the distance that is traveled in medium 2. Let the phase shift constant in medium 2 be k 2, so that by the time it reaches the other interface, it becomes E t 1 2 e to the power minus j k 2 times d. All right. Now, at this interface again, part of the wave is going to be transmitted, which may be called ET, and following our convention ET23, and part of the wave is going to be reflected back, let us say like this, where this may be called ER23. Okay. So, what reaches here is therefore ER23 e to the power minus j k 2 d, where once again part of it is going to be transmitted through, becoming ET21 following our convention, and part of the wave is going to be reflected back in this manner, and what is reflected back may be called ER21, which when which upon reaching here becomes ER21 e to the power minus j k 2 d, and part of it is transmitted through, becoming ET23 prime, and part of it is reflected back, becoming ER23 prime, and becoming ER23 prime e to the power minus j k 2 d, and this is ER21 prime, etcetera. This becomes ET21 prime. Okay, and this series of reflections and transmissions is going to continue. Okay, and as I mentioned, it is only for the sake of clarity that the wave paths are being shown inclined to the interface plates. Otherwise, all these reflections, transmissions, and the wave incidents are normal to these interfaces.
So, ER23, when it reaches the interface between 1 and 2, does it become ER23 raised to minus j k 2 t or plus?
Yeah. See, the convention that we have been following for the phase shift is always that in the direction of travel, the phase is going to decrease. Okay? So, we are being consistent in following that convention. Otherwise, you have rightly noticed that the direction of propagation of this wave is opposite to that of the other wave, but the way we put down the phase shifts, it is all right. Now, since the various reflections and transmissions are going to be governed by the reflection coefficient and the transmission coefficient at the various interfaces, let us put down these coefficients. We will have first, let us say R12, okay, using the notation that R12 is the reflection coefficient for a wave traveling from medium 1 into medium 2, okay, which will be equal to eta 2 minus eta 1 upon eta 2 plus eta 1, assuming that the etas are the intrinsic impedances of the two media. Similarly, T12, as we know, is going to be 1 plus R12. On the other hand, what will be R21, reflection coefficient for a wave incident on the interface between media 2 and 1, traveling from medium 2, that will be eta 1 minus eta 2 upon eta 1 plus eta 2, so that it is minus R12, and accordingly T21, the transmission in a similar situation, is going to be 1 plus R 2 1, so that it is 1 minus R 1 2. We are also going to require R 2 3, which is similarly eta 3 minus eta 2 upon eta 3 plus eta 2 and T 2 3, which is 1 plus R 2 3. So, armed with this picture and these coefficients, reflection and transmission coefficients, we can now consider what is the overall reflection back into medium 1 and what is the overall transmission through the plane slab. We will have to consider these various contributions for reflection, let us say, and the various contributions for transmission. But if we proceed systematically, it will be possible to come to a simple result. Let us consider what is reflected back in medium 1. The first term in the series of various reflections that are going to be added to find out the overall reflection is going to be ER 1 2, which is going to be R 1 2 times EI, right. The second term is going to be ET 2 1, which is going to be T 2 1 into ER 2 3 e to the power minus j k 2 d. And then ER 2 3 can be traced back to EI through a reflection here and a transmission here and two phase shifts with magnitude k 2 d. Okay. So, on this basis ET 2 1 can be written as T 2 1 times R 2 3 times T 1 2 and e to the power minus 2 j k 2 d times E I. This becomes our, let us say, equation 1. This is equation 2. Next, let us put down E R 2 1. Okay. In terms of this, we will be able to get E T 2 1 prime. And therefore, let us put down E R 2 1, which is going to be R 2 1 and then E R 2 3 e to the power minus j k 2 d. And therefore, in the above expression, if we interchange T 2 1 and R 2 1, we should get E R 2 1. And doing exactly that, we get this as R 2 1. R 2 3 T 1 2 e to the power minus 2 j k 2 d into E I, which may be equation 3. In terms of E R 2 1, now we can get E T 2 1 prime. E T 2 1 prime is going to be T 2 1 E R 2 3 prime e to the power minus j k 2 d. And tracing these series of reflections and transmissions, one can make out that e t 2 1 prime can be written in two parts as t 2 1 r 2 3 times t 1 2 e to the power minus 2 j k 2 d. This becomes the first part in the expression for e t 2 1 prime, and the second part becomes r 2 1 r 2 3 e to the power minus 2 j k 2 d times, of course, e I, which may be our equation 4. Okay. Similarly, one can put down e r 2 1 prime, which is going to be r 2 1 r 2 3 t 1 2 e to the power minus 2 j k 2 d times r 2 1 r 2 3 e to the power minus 2 j k 2 d into e I, which is equation 5. If you have any questions, we can tackle those now.
Product of the first term.
Yeah, it is the product of this term and this term. Let's say we are talking about ET 21 prime. Okay, ET 21 prime is this, and we are writing it in terms of EI. Okay, so you can start at this point T 12, then R 23, then R 21, and then R 23, and then T 21. So, this will be the coefficients, and then the travels that we made, 1, 2, 3, 4 travels that we made, phase shifts corresponding to those. So, this way it is possible to check the final result that we have reached.
So, T 2 1 is not coming.
It will come, you just check. T 2 1 is here in any case. Okay. This is the final term that will come.
So
final coefficient.
So the phase for shift. So the because of reflection there will be some phase change.
Because of
reflection also there will be some shift in the phase.
No, whatever phase shifts are there because of reflection and transmission, those are taken into account in the coefficients. Right. So we don't need to talk about those phase shifts. We are multiplying by the coefficients. If they are real, there is no phase shift. If they are complex, they will contribute their phase shift appropriately, right. So, now this way, if we consider ET 21 and ET 21 prime, it is possible to see a pattern. There will be a common term and there will be a common ratio of these various terms which constitute an infinite series. Okay. And therefore, we can say that ER, which is going to be E r 1 2 plus E t 2 1 plus E t 2 1 prime etcetera, so that E r by E I, which is the reflection coefficient that we are interested in, we may call it rho or small r. Rho is the symbol we have been using earlier, and small r is what we have used for the other component coefficients in this case. That is only a matter of notation. So, E r by E I is going to be equal to, as one can see from there, r 1 2 plus a s plus a s squared etcetera, where a is the first term of this series with the value t 2 1 r 2 3 t 1 2 e to the power minus 2 j k 2 d, and s is the common ratio with the value R21 R23 into e to the power minus 2j k2 d, so that the summation is quite straightforward and it is going to be R12 plus a upon 1 minus s, so that it is T21 R23 T12 e to the power minus 2j k2 d in the numerator, and in the denominator we have 1 minus R21 R23 e to the power minus 2j k2 d. Next, we write the transmission coefficients in terms of the reflection coefficients, just to reduce the number of variables or the quantities which need to be calculated in this expression, so that this becomes R12, and then T21 is 1 minus R12, T12 is 1 plus R12, so that we will have 1 minus R12 squared into R23 into exponential of minus 2j k2 d in the numerator, and in the denominator we will have also recognizing that R21 is minus R12, it will be 1 plus R12 R23 exponential minus 2j a2 d. Okay, using the space on the left hand side, this can be simplified and we get the expression for rho as R23 times the exponent, and then R12 in the numerator, R12 plus R23 e to the power minus 2j k2 d divided by the same numerator denominator, that is 1 plus R12 R23 e to the power minus 2j k2 d. Okay, which expression is quite compact even though we have added an infinite series. All right, to interpret this expression and to see how it could be utilized in practice, let us simplify it further, and let us now make the assumption that the media that we are dealing with are perfect dielectrics. What will be the simplification caused by this? If the media are perfect dielectrics, then these various coefficients are completely real, and therefore we can now consider the magnitude of rho or magnitude of rho squared. Since these coefficients are all real, now we need to worry about only the exponential term. Okay, and we get R12 whole squared plus R23 whole squared plus 2 R12 R23 cosine of 2 k2 d in the numerator, considering that magnitude squared is the square of the real part plus the square of the imaginary part. And similarly, in the denominator we get 1 plus r1 2 squared r2 3 squared plus 2 r1 2 r2 3 cosine of 2 k 2 d. Okay, which is the expression for the magnitude of the square of the reflection coefficient. Okay, and now one can derive or obtain a very useful application of this expression. We pose the question that for such a plane slab, for such a situation involving three media, is it possible to eliminate reflections completely? That is it possible to have magnitude rho squared or rho equal to 0? Okay. And for that purpose, we will just put the, we will try to see when the numerator becomes equal to 0. And it is possible to make the numerator 0 if we have r1 2 equal to r2 3, and also if we have cosine of 2 k 2 d equal to minus 1. Both conditions are required, okay, to make the reflection coefficient numerator equal to 0. Let us consider the implication of these conditions. The expressions for r1 2 and r2 3 are here, and therefore, we just write down eta 2 minus eta 1 upon eta 2 plus eta 1 should be equal to eta 3 minus eta 2 upon eta 3 plus eta 2. Okay. And since we have already made the assumption that we are dealing with perfect dielectrics, etas can be replaced by the corresponding epsilons or the permittivities, square root of the permittivities, and therefore, this becomes root epsilon 1 minus root epsilon 2 upon root epsilon 1 plus root epsilon 2, and here we have root epsilon 2 minus root epsilon 3 upon the summation of the same terms, which yields the simple result that epsilon 1 upon epsilon 2 is equal to epsilon 2 upon epsilon 3, or epsilon 2 is equal to the geometric mean of epsilon 1 and epsilon 3. Okay. We have obtained this kind of result in a different context earlier, okay, in the context of a quarter wave matching section on a transmission line. And here also you see that somewhat similar result is coming. Okay. So, this correspondence between the plane wave phenomena and the transmission line phenomena, we shall draw upon, we shall make more formal a little later, but right now let us just notice the similarity. So, if the permittivity of medium 2 is related to the permittivities of the medium on media on the either side, then this is one of the conditions for eliminating reflections back into medium 1. What is the implication of the second condition? This amounts to saying that twice k 2 d is equal to an odd multiple of pi radians, so that it is 2 m plus 1 into pi, yielding a condition on d that d is equal to 2 m plus 1 into pi by 2 k 2, where What is K2? K2 is the phase shift constant in medium 2, so that it is 2 pi by lambda 2, and using this result it becomes 2 m plus 1 by 4 into lambda 2, where lambda 2 is the wavelength in medium 2 and can be further related to the wavelength in free space as lambda naught by square root of the dielectric constant of medium 2 for the simple case that we are considering that the media are perfect dielectrics. Okay. So, that this is a standard relation for the wavelength in a certain medium for a uniform plane wave to the wavelength in free space in terms of the square root of the dielectric constant.
Not only for perfect dielectric, but all the.
Well, wherever the velocity can be written as the 1 by square root of mu epsilon, there this result will hold good. Okay. Just therefore, just to be on the safe side, we are saying that for perfect dielectrics, this is the wavelength. K 2 is serving the same role as beta for this medium, so that it is omega square root of mu 2 epsilon 2, okay, for the perfect dielectric that we are considering it to be.
So, lambda 2 is lambda naught by epsilon 1 2.
Epsilon r 2, relative permittivity of the second medium.
The lambda naught is in the first
medium. Lambda naught is the wavelength in free space for the frequency of the incident wave. Okay. The result that we have derived here says that in such a situation, the reflections can be completely avoided, provided the permittivities are related like this and the second medium has thickness which is an odd multiple of quarter wavelength, where the wavelength is the wavelength in the medium 2, okay, which again is a result very similar to what we obtained for the quarter wave matching section. And as we mentioned there, this concept is utilized very frequently in eliminating reflections from lenses and other optical items. Okay. And this is the basis of what is called the anti-reflection coating. Right. Although, as we consider this more deeply, it becomes clear that the anti-reflection coating will have zero reflection only at the design wavelength, only where the thickness of the coating satisfies this relation that it is an odd multiple of quarter wavelength, where the wavelength is the wavelength in that medium. All right. Apart from acting as an anti-reflection coating in the context of optical elements, this concept can be utilized for reducing reflections from aircraft and missiles also, so that they become less easily detectable by the enemy radars. Used in this context, that is for reducing the reflections from the point of view of radar, takes us into what is called the radar absorbing material field. Okay. A RAM is a radar absorbing material, and this concept applied to that will imply that if we have a suitable coating on the surface of the aircraft or on the surface of the missile satisfying these conditions, it will be possible to minimize reflections. But the limitations of this idea also become
obvious as you ponder about it. First of all, the reflection will be zero only at particular wavelengths or only at particular frequencies. Alright? And secondly, the results have been derived for the case of normal incidence. And when these conditions are not maintained, obviously the coating is going to yield some reflection. Okay? And therefore, digressing a little bit here, what may be more useful from the point of view of radar absorbing material, which acts over a broader range of frequencies, is perhaps an arrangement which looks like this. Let's say this is the missile, okay, and we provide a coating. The coating is highly exaggerated for the sake of clarity, okay, which has a mu and epsilon such that their ratio is equal to the intrinsic impedance of the free space, okay, so that eta naught is equal to square root of mu by epsilon, or if the medium is conducting, in the more general case, it is j omega mu upon sigma plus j omega epsilon, okay, or in which case reflections from this interface can be avoided over a very broad range of frequencies. Alright. Further, if the medium is made lossy,
so these mu and epsilon are the
R of the coating. Okay. If you like, you could put subscript C to show very clearly that these are the properties of the medium which is being used for coating purposes. Now, this only ensures that there is no reflection at this interface. But part of the wave, but the wave that enters here will be reflected back and will be available for the detection purposes. So this does not serve the purpose. So if the medium is lossy, and if the medium says that it provides sufficient loss so that the wave which has travelled this path in this medium is sufficiently reduced in amplitude, then the reflections can be considerably avoided. Okay? So, development of this kind of radar absorbing materials, which are effective over a broad range of frequencies, is of a great strategic importance from the point of view of defense. Okay? And an active area of research. Now, let us proceed further and consider once again the expression for the reflection coefficient that we had derived earlier. And what we have is the magnitude of rho squared. Okay. And this time we write the reflection coefficient magnitude square for another special case where, let's say, medium 1 is the same as medium
3.
Sorry, medium 3. Okay. What is the effect on these coefficients for this? We will have R 2, 3 equal to R 1, 2 for this case. Minus R 1, 2. Okay. You just replace eta 3 by eta 1 and the result is obvious. So for this conditions, the magnitude rho squared turns out to be, if you look at the previous expression, twice r12 squared, and then we have 1 minus cosine of 2k2d divided by 1 plus r12 raised to the power 4 minus 2r12 squared cosine of 2k2d, which can be simplified by expressing the cosine in terms of half the angle, and it simplifies to 4
r12
whole squared and then sine of k2d divided by the same numerator, yeah, thank you, sine squared 1 plus r12 to the power 4 minus 2r12 squared cosine of 2k2d. And in this case, that is when media on either side of the plane slab are identical, the reflection coefficient is going to be 0 when k2d is going to be a multiple of pi radians, that is k2d equal to n pi, n equal to an integer, so that d is equal to n times pi by k2, and as before, since k2 is 2 pi by lambda 2, what we get here is n times lambda 2 by 2, with lambda 2 once again being equal to lambda naught by square root of epsilon r. And we find that if the thickness of the second medium for this condition is a multiple of half wavelength, half lambda 2, then also there are no reflections back into medium 1. Okay? This kind of a slab, plane slab, satisfying this condition is called a half wave plane, or a half wavelength plane. And what we saw earlier, which could serve as an anti-reflection coating, is called a quarter wavelength plane. Okay. What could be the applications of this observation? What is the observation? The observation is that if we have identical media on the either side of a plane slab, and the plane slab is a multiple of half wavelength in thickness, then there are no reflections, either for a wave incident from medium 3 or for a wave incident from medium 1. Okay, so this observation is utilized in making what are called radomes. A radome can be considered to be a word derived from a combination of two words, let's say dome for a radar. Okay? And it provides environmental protection to the antenna. Antenna of a radar or of a communication system. You know that the antenna is exposed to the severities of the weather, and therefore its performance can degrade with course of time, or let's say when rain or snow fall on the antenna surface. Okay, and these problems can be avoided by putting what is called a radome. And let's consider a usual dish antenna, which you would have seen in many places. Let's say it looks like this. Okay, it is actually a paraboloidal reflector antenna. Then it has a feature which is called a baffle, which we can discuss later. And now if you put a window here, which at the operating frequency or which at the operating frequency is a half wavelength or multiple of a half wavelength, then it will be completely transparent to the signals that are transmitted or to the signals that are received, providing at the same time environmental protection to this antenna. The radomes can take many different shapes depending on the application or depending on the requirement. For example, if the antenna is required to be rotated, okay, then one could put a spherical radome covering the entire antenna, okay, or else to reduce cost it may be just a window in this manner. I am sure you can recognize this shape, and you've seen this on top of many buildings in Delhi. So the purpose of this dielectric window is to provide environmental protection and to remain transparent at the same time. Okay, so the hard work that we had done in deriving the reflection coefficient has these two obviously very interesting and important applications. One is in providing anti-reflection coating, and the other is in providing protection to antennas in communication systems and radars. Now we can proceed further. And consider the total field that is transmitted through the plane slab. And in this case, we proceed in a similar manner and consider the addition of wave types, which are dt equal to dt to t plus dt to t prime plus dt to t double prime, etc. Which again is an infinite series, and the expressions for these various components in the series, various terms in the series, can be worked out in a very similar manner as we did for finding out the reflection coefficient. Okay, and on that basis when we find out the transmission coefficient, which is going to be dt by dI. Okay, in this case also it turns out to be a geometric progression with terms reading as a1 plus a1s plus a1s squared, etc. Okay, where a1 is t1 to t2 3 e to the power minus j k to b, and s retains the same value as earlier, that is r21 r23 e to the power minus 2j k to d, so that the transmission coefficient is a1 upon 1 minus s, that is t1 to t23 e to the power minus j k to d.
So a1 is e to the power minus j k to d a2.
Single, without a factor of 2. Okay, that can be made out from the first term here. Okay, there is a single phase shift in the first term. So that's what will come out as a common fact. And then 1 minus s, so that it is 1 minus r21 r23 e to the power minus 2j k to b. Making substitutions as before, expressing the transmission coefficients in terms of the reflection coefficients, one obtains some more simpler expression for the transmission coefficient, reading 1 plus R12 into 1 plus R23 t to the power minus j k to d upon 1 plus R12 times R23 t to the power minus 2j k to d, which more or less completes our discussion on the feature called plane slab. Now here we have derived these results for the deflection coefficient and transmission coefficient considering a series of reflections and transmissions, okay, which provides a somewhat clear insight into what is actually happening inside the plane slab, where we have interactions of the wave with two interfaces. Okay, however, there are alternative methods available which are less tedious, but they do not incorporate this kind of clear understanding. Before we stop, let me pose a question. Supposing we are required to find out the total power transmitted through such a slab, then what are we going to be required to be doing?
Square the transmission coefficient.
One straightforward method, as the answer has come, is to calculate the transmission coefficient and hence calculate the pointing vector. Okay? But if we already have calculated the reflection coefficient, then it is not really necessary. We just calculate what is the power reflected back, okay? And if we assume that the plane slab is non-absorbing, is non-lossy, then whatever is not reflected back is going to be transmitted through the plane slab. Okay? So this is where we like to stop, unless you have some questions.
So this is 1 minus R12.
No.
Yes, we will just have calculated the transmission coefficient one plus the reflection
coefficient. Different number of reflections. The entire trial has been rejected or transmitted. So, ET plus ER should be.
Okay, perhaps we can discuss that in the tutorial. Let us stop here.